Calvary this morning. We're going to have a great time in the house of the Lord today. I'm expecting God to do great things, mighty things, miracle things, supernatural things. That's what I'm believing from our God today, because our God is able. Amen. You can be seated this morning. Brother Andy's going to receive our Sunday school offering. And what a crazy world we live in. Crazy world we live in today. What a sinful world we live in. But where sin abounds, grace does much more abound. If there's one thing that as I look around our world and see all of the things that are happening in it, all of the, let's just call it sin, that's in our world today, it's very easy for us to become discouraged, to become distracted, maybe even to become a little depressed as we look around our world. But let me encourage you today that the more sin that's in our world, it just lets me know that the grace of God is that much more abundant for each and every person. Amen. I've been saying all throughout this week, we've been having our youth week and having a great time. Anytime somebody mentions something that's going on in our world, I've just looked back at them and said, come quickly, Lord Jesus. Come quickly, Lord Jesus. Why did you say that? Because the Bible says to encourage one another with these words that Jesus is coming. It's very easy for us to become deterred and distracted, to become concerned even with all of the happenings in the world. But if we keep our eyes on God, we keep our eyes on heaven, we keep our eyes on the goal, we won't become distracted as easily, and we can encourage one another with these words that Jesus is coming soon, and I can hardly wait for that day to happen. Amen, amen. Romans chapter 8, verse number 31. I've got an encouraging word for Calvary this morning. If you don't leave encouraged, I'm going to leave encouraged. Not that you left discouraged or not encouraged, but I'm just going to believe God and trust God and stand on His word today. I tell you what, there's a lot of things that have changed in our world. This is not your grandparents' United States of America. This is not your parents' United States of America. There's a lot of things that have changed, but if there's one thing that stayed constant, it's the word of God. It's forever settled. It has not moved. It has not changed. We might as well just do it. If anything has changed, it's us. We've changed. But the word is forever settled. That's why when we become discouraged or we become distracted, get in the Word, because it will get us back to where we need to be. Amen. It's an anchor in life's ocean, the Word of God. Amen. Romans chapter 8, verse number 31. There's a lot of fighting that's going on in our world today. A lot of confusion in the world today. God is not the author of confusion.
Right, amen.
There's a lot of fighting that's going on, a lot of turmoil in our world. But Romans chapter 8, verse 31 says this. What are we going to say to these things? What are we going to say when all of this stuff is happening? If God is for us, who can be against us? Wars and rumors of wars. If God is for us, then who can be against us? Pestilence and famine, pandemics. If God is for us, then who can be against us? I want to talk to you today on this thought: God is fighting for us. Collectively, God is fighting for us. But individually, even this morning, I want to encourage you, God is fighting for you. And if God is for us, then who can be against us? In the book of Judges, beginning at chapter 6, we can read an account of a man named Gideon. And this was not a good time in the history of God's people, Israel. But Israel was wanting to be like the other nations. And they had decided to have a ruler over them that would act as a contact or as a connection, as a liaison between them and God. And the problem with the concept of having a king was that God never intended for Israel to be like the other nations. The children of Israel were the called out ones. They were the separated people. They were the ones that were supposed to be different. That's what God's people are. But in Israel's quest to try to be accepted by the other nations, in their desire and wanting to be relevant to their society, they insisted upon having a ruler over them. They wanted to be relevant to their society. And so they wanted to be like the other nations. And the intriguing thing to me this morning is that God allowed this to happen. Now, because they were so persistent in wanting to have this ruler over them, to be like the other nations, Judges chapter 6 begins by stating in verse number 1, "And the children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord." Imagine that. Israel wants to be like the other nations. Israel wants to be like the world. Israel wants to be accepted by the world. And wouldn't you know that just in a few years' time, that's exactly who they were. Because once you allow the influence of the world to be in your family, in your home, and in your life, that's when we start becoming more like the world. That's why we got to dig into the Word. Because we don't want to be more like the world. We want to be more like the Word. Let me give you some advice here this morning. John, 1 John chapter 2, verse number 15 says this. It gives us some instruction today. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, then the love of the Father is not in him. Now, that's not talking about creation. That's not talking about humankind, that we shouldn't love those. That's not what it's talking about. Don't fall in love with the things of the world. That's what John is instructing us. And that's a whole nother message in and of itself, so I won't go into that today. Let's talk about Gideon. Judges chapter 6, verse number 1. The children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord. And the Lord, watch this now, delivered them. Midian, the Midianites did not overtake them. The Lord delivered them into the hand of the Midianites. For 7 years, this is what would happen. Israel would plant crops, and the Midianites would come in and destroy. The Midianites, the Israelites would get oxen. They would get some donkeys. They would get some possessions, and the Midianites would come in and destroy what they had gathered. For 7 years, the Midianites wreak havoc on the people of God. 7 years of torment. 7 years of torture, 7 years of destruction. And finally, there's an Israelite that gets smart enough to realize that, hey, the last 7 years, they haven't been going very well for us. And what has changed is we've become more like them. And so an Israelite finally stands up and declares, we need God's help today. Can I challenge Calvary something here this morning? I don't know what you're going through, and I don't know the test or trial you may be standing strong in, but let me reiterate to you, God is fighting for us today. You just got to get a backbone and a courage to be able to stand up and say, God, I need your help today. Amen. So the Midianites are wreaking havoc on God's people for 7 years. Verse number 6 says this, Israel was greatly impoverished because of the Midianites. They destroyed them year after year. We do not want them to become what they can be. We do not want them to become what they used to be. And so we will keep going back and attacking them so that we can keep them where we want them to be. And so Israel was greatly impoverished because of the enemy. And the children of Israel cried out to the Lord. And it came to pass when the children of Israel cried out unto the Lord because of the Midianites, because of their adversary, because of the circumstance they were in. Watch this. The Lord gave them exactly the answer that they were asking for. No. You want to be like the other nations. You want to have a king over you. I'm going to place a prophet in your path. And I'm going to speak to you through the prophet. And so the Lord sends a prophet unto the children of Israel. And this is what the prophecy says. I'm going to read it from the Message translation here this morning. It says, God, the God of Israel says, I delivered you from Egypt. He's trying to help them to remember where they had come from. I delivered you from Egypt. I freed you from a life of slavery. I rescued you from Egypt's brutality and from every oppressor. I pushed them out of your way. I cleared the path for you. I gave you their land. And I told you that I am God. I am your God. Don't for a minute be afraid of the gods of the Amorites in whose land you are now currently living. I gave you all of these things, but you did not listen to me. You did not obey me. Now, the next part of this story has always been intriguing to me because the angel appears next. The angel of the Lord comes to a man named Gideon. And Gideon is separating the good wheat from the bad wheat. He's sifting the wheat and he's hiding it from the Midianites. Like, you guys are coming in and destroying my stuff. I'm going to find me a safe place. So he finds a cave and he begins to hide his stash in the cave. And he's afraid that if the Midianites find him and the stash that he has, they're going to do him in. And so Gideon is in the cave and he's trying to separate the good wheat and the bad wheat. And the angel of the Lord appears unto him and said, the Lord is with you. Yeah. Yeah. Woo. Yeah. You mighty man of valor. Yeah. I think Gideon probably looked around and said, I think you got the wrong cave. I'm in here hiding. I don't want anybody to know where I'm at. And you just said, you had me when you said God was with me. But then you called me a mighty man of valor. And so now I'm pondering here. I'm not sure you're talking to the right guy. And so Gideon, after he peels himself off the cave floor, experiencing this angelic being that came to him, he said, if God is with us, then why are we suffering the things that we are going through? If God is with us, why has all of this stuff happened to us. And maybe you're in this place today and you have those same questions going through your mind. If God is fighting for us and if God is on my side, why am I going through the things that we are going through? I can see as Gideon begins to question, I remember all of the miracles, the signs, and the wonders that God did for my grandparents and for my parents. But I haven't seen many of those things taking place here over the last couple of years. And so Gideon has a lot of questions in his mind about the current condition of Israel. But this is what Gideon did not understand at this moment. God had chosen him to be the deliverer of his people. God had chosen Gideon to facilitate the deliverance that he had for his entire people. It was not just a deliverance for Gideon. It was not just a deliverance for Gideon's family. It was a deliverance for the entire nation. Can I tell Calvary something here today? We need a revival, not just for us. We need a revival, not just for our family. We need a revival for our nation. Could it be that God has chosen you and you and you to be the facilitator of the revival that he has for us today? And so Gideon did not understand the position that God had placed him in. God had chosen Gideon to be the deliverer for his family. God had chosen Gideon to be the deliverer for the nation. And he reiterated to Gideon, hey, I want you to understand, I'm on your side. God is with you, you mighty man of valor. And so Gideon listens to the voice of God. And he says, I'll do what you want me to do. God said, well, you need to go clean out the camp. You become too much like the world. You're looking like the world. You're acting like the world. You're talking like the world. You need to go and clean the camp out a little bit. That's a message all in itself, but go home and clean the camp a little bit. Just wanted that to sit in for a minute. So Gideon listens to the, it's easy for us to collect stuff. I'm not even talking that it's sinful stuff. You might have to just get rid of some stuff that's just become a weight. Something that's just kind of holding you back a little bit. I'm not telling you that you're living in sin or anything like that. I'm just telling you today, sometimes a good cleaning goes a long way. All you ladies ought to say amen. Oh, so Gideon listens to the voice of the Lord. He goes back to the camp and he tears down the false idols that have been set up to Baal. This is God's people that he has already delivered them. And in just a few years, they've set up idols to other gods. He cuts down the groves. Don't touch that. That's one of the untouchables. This is a grove we put here. This is a compilation of stuff that we're setting up for the idol Baal. But Gideon walks in and says, hey, all this stuff's coming down. If you want to be delivered today, there's some things that got to go down. And so Gideon goes in, cuts down the groves that they had constructed to the false gods. Watch this now. He did not just tear down the things that they had set up. But after he has cleaned the camp, the first thing he did was built an altar. He cleaned out the camp, and then he built an altar. Go home and clean out the camp, and then build an altar. I want to tell Calvary something here today. The reason why Gideon went back to the camp, doesn't say anybody was with him. Gideon went back to the camp, and either he tore the idols down himself, or he convinced enough of the guys that were there, hey, this is what we've got to do. But he tore the stuff down. Why? He was so convinced of the future of Israel that it affected him in the time he was living at the moment. And so, Calvary, let me tell you something here today. We must be convinced of our future to the point where it affects us now. We don't have another day to waste. We may not have another week, month, or year left on this planet, because the signs of the times are quickly dropping like flies. There's wars and rumors of wars, and there's pestilence, and there's pandemics, and there's all kinds of things that are lining up with the book of Revelation and all of the stuff that's going to be happening in the end times. And so we must be so convinced of our future and where we are going and where we are headed that it affects us now. That when you go into Walmart, it's not just a cashier. There's a soul that's standing before you. You see, that's what the new birth is all about. The new birth is this. We're so convinced about where we want to go and who we want to see, that God is God and that Jesus is going to be in heaven when we get there, and I'm going to make heaven my home, and I'm going to be so convinced that I want to experience the new birth, a changing of who I am into who I should be. And so that's what the new birth is all about. We're so convinced of our future that we change now. I am so convinced that heaven is real, and I am so convinced that hell is hot, that I'm going to do something today. I'm going to do something now so that I can alter my eternal destination. I've come to declare to Calvary, you must still repent. You must still be baptized in Jesus' name for the remission of your sins. And you must be filled with the Spirit of God. Can I tell each and every person that's here today, we must be convinced of our future to the point that it affects us now. Look at your neighbor and tell him, say, God is fighting for us. When the people see that Gideon has destroyed the idols of Baal, they're enraged. They're mad. They were living in such sin and bondage that they didn't even realize that the prophet had come to deliver them. And so they turn on Gideon, and they want to kill him. They even give him a nickname. Sticks and stones may break my bone, but words will never hurt me. And yet that's the first thing we let fly. Ooh, maybe I'm preaching to myself here today. Help me, Lord. But they give Gideon a nickname. Jerubbaal. Jerubbaal. If you can pronounce it better, go for it. But Jerubbaal. And literally it means this: let Baal fight his own battles. Basically what they were telling Gideon is this: we're turning you over to Baal. We're going to let Baal defend his own cause. The prophet comes with the words of deliverance, and they say, well, we're going to let Baal fight his battles. And so turn with me to Judges chapter 7 and verse number 1. This is what I want to get to here today, because God is fighting for each and every one of you. Then Jerubbaal. Then they put a little comma in here to let us know who it is. Who is Gideon? And all the people that were with him rose up early and pitched beside the well of Herod, so that the host of the Midianites were on the north side of them by the hill of Morah in the valley. Watch this. And the Lord said unto Gideon. Whoa. I thought they had changed his name. But the Lord said unto Gideon, listen, when you begin to hear the voice of God speaking into your life, when you begin to tear down the false doctrines and the false gods that may have risen up in your life, there will be those that may try to give you a nickname. They may try to call you a holy roller. They may try to call you all kinds of things. They may call you Jerubbaal. But when God speaks to you, he's going to call you by your name. Somebody ought to be excited about that today. He's not going to call you by the nickname that the world gives to you, but he's going to call you by his own name. And so the armies of the Midianites rise up against Gideon, and there were 135,000 men, and Gideon had 32,000. Gideon says, well, we're a little outnumbered here. Maybe we can get some more people on our side. We're at a 4-to-1 odds here. And God says, nah, you've got too many. God, they have 135,000. I've kind of scrounged around, and the best I can get is 32,000. Yeah, that's too many. Tell everybody that's fearful. Tell everybody that's afraid. Go back home. So that's what Gideon does. If you're afraid, you're fearful, I understand, go back home. And they start leaving in droves. So now, the army, the Midianites, is still at 135,000 because they're not afraid. And Gideon's down to 10,000. So now we're at 13-to-1 odds. And Gideon hears the voice of the Lord again. And God says, you still got too many. I need to go back to the cave and talk to that angel again. Conversation's not going like I planned. We just sent 22,000 people back home, and now you're telling me we still have too many. Yes. Okay. Take them down to the water. Water's a good separation place. Whew. Verse number 5. Everyone that lappeth of the water with his tongue, as a dog lappeth, send him by himself. Everyone that bows down upon his knees to drink, separate them. And the number of them that lapped, putting their hand to their mouth, were 300 men. But all the rest of the people bowed down upon their knees to drink the water. So Gideon says, whew, good. I only lost 300 this time. The Lord says, those that were watching while they were drinking, those are the ones you need. It started out as 135,000 against 32,000. And then it changed to 135,000 to 10,000. And now it's 135,000 to 300. In case you have not figured it out, we are now at 450-to-1 odds. Place your bets now. In order for us to experience the supernatural like we want to experience the supernatural, we have to first encounter an impossible situation. In order for God to work a miracle for us, we must first be in need of a miracle. In order for God to heal us, we must first have a sickness that God can work in. And we have to be out of options. And so watch this. God tells Gideon, and this is the key for somebody here today. God tells him, you and your servant need to go down to the enemy's camp, and you need to listen to what the Midianites are saying about you. You need to go down to where the enemy is camped and just kind of eavesdrop on what they're saying about you. Because the enemy does not have the same perception as what you do. It's not God and the devil. It's God and nobody else, because there's nobody like him. I know sometimes we kind of pit one against the other and say, well, God's here and the devil's here and the devil's got just as much. No, he doesn't. He's not omnipresent. He can't tell what you're thinking, what you're saying, what you're going to do. Sometimes I think we give the devil too much credit. Sometimes it's just life that happens. And you hit the pothole dead center and pop the tire. It had nothing to do with the devil. I refuse to give the devil any type of encouragement over what may be happening in my family, in this church, or anything. Devil, let me tell you something. You can't touch us because we're covered by the blood of Jesus. So I refuse to let the enemy get any credit for what I may be going through. And so God tells Gideon, go down to the camp and hear what they're saying. Judges chapter 7, verses 13 and 14. And I'm quickly coming to a close here today. Gideon comes down to the camp. And there was a man that told a dream unto his fellows. And this is what he said. I dreamed a dream, and lo, a cake of barley, bread crumbled in, tumbled into the host of Midian, and came unto a tent, and smote it, that it fell, and overturned it, that the tent lay long. Let me tell you my dream. This big cake came rolling out of the hills and rolled through a tent and destroyed everything. Now, I am not an interpreter of dreams. But if you tell me that, I'm probably going to ask you if you had too much pizza last night. A barley cake comes rolling through the tent and destroys it. Watch this now. Those fellows that he's telling it to, they said, whoa, this is nothing but the sword of Gideon. The enemy was probably more tuned in to what was going on than what I would have been at that time. But if I'm Gideon's servant and I'm standing beside him and I'm hearing somebody talk about a dream of a barley cake rolling down the hill and destroying a camp, probably saying, did we take a wrong turn here? But the enemy said, there's only one solution or answer to what this dream may be. In verse number 14, this is nothing else save the sword of Gideon, the son of Joash, a man of Israel. For into his hand hath God delivered Midian and all of the host. And when Gideon hears the dream, and he hears the interpretation of the dream, when Gideon hears what the adversary is saying about him, he runs back to the 300 men that he had gathered, and he said, saddle up, boys, it's time to ride. We're going down to the enemy's camp, and we're going to take back everything that they've stolen from us. For the Lord has delivered Midian into our hands. I wonder, is there a group of people at Calvary today? And you would saddle up with me right now and know that God is fighting for us. So Gideon tells them, he says, hey guys, when we get down to there, you just do what I do. Just trust me. Well, you handed me a trumpet. You handed me a pitcher. Just trust me. When we get to the camp, whatever I do, you do. I was watching a video just the other day, and it was of a basketball game. And they had their flag out for their high school, and they were waving it on the sidelines. And all of a sudden, from the other side of the gymnasium, there was a guy, and he was over here. And they're over there celebrating, and they're waving their flag. And all of a sudden, you see coming into the screen, this guy's running over with his flag, and he stands right in front of him, and he just starts going like this. What's he doing? I don't care what type of flag you're waving. And you may be winning right now, but I'm here to rally the troops. I'm here to rally the team. I've come to tell Calvary something here today. God is fighting for us. It doesn't matter the test or trial you're going through. Wave the flag. Jesus is on our side. God is fighting for us. So Gideon goes back and gets the 300 men. Brother James, come up here real quick. I got to close. Anybody know what the Hebrew meaning of the word Gideon is? Anybody? This is what I found. The name Gideon in Hebrew is this: destroyer one who has a stump in place of a hand. The name Gideon means destroyer one who has a stump in place of a hand. Now, there's some things I'm going to do when I get to heaven. One of those things, I'll be finding old Gideon saying, "Hey, bud, I know you've got two hands now. But was there a time that you only had one? Could it be? Could it be? I cannot confirm or deny. But could it be that God was saying, I can beat the adversary with one arm tied behind my back?" Gideon, you can't fight. You can't lead that army. God's fighting for me. We can't have revival, but God's fighting for us. My family is in shambles, but God is fighting for us. What more shall we say to these things? Can I prophesy to you today? If God is for us, then who can be against us? If you receive that word today, why don't you stand to your feet and lift your hands and lift your voice? And begin to call on the God of heaven and say, "God, I need your help right now. God, I need your help right now. I need your help right now." Woo! God, we need your help right now in the circumstance that we're in. God, we need your help right now in the trial that we're going through. God, we need your help today. And we know that you will fight for us. I've come to tell you and encourage you today. If God is on your side, there's no weapon that is formed against you that's going to prosper. You are more than a conqueror today. I see the sick being healed. I see prodigals coming back home. I see job opportunities that will enhance the kingdom. I see your spouse being saved. I see grandparents and parents being saved here today. Why? Because God is fighting for us. Woo! That's all right. Fill this house right now with the sound of the praise of God's people. Lift up your voice. You may have knocked, but I'm asking you to knock again. You may have asked, but I'm telling you, ask again. Believe for it here today. I stand on your promise today, God. I declare your word today, oh God. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. God, for each and every person that's in this building right now, for those that are sitting in the parking lot listening in, God, we declare your goodness over them. I declare your mercy over them right now. God, I pour out blessings upon them right now. God, we call on your name and we plead your blood today, because we know that you are fighting for us. We know you're fighting for us, oh God. We can't do it on our own. We're not going to rely on our own understanding, on our own power, or our own intellect. We're going to call on the name.